China's central bank has a new governor. State media confirmed Pan Gongsheng's appointment, replacing Yi Gang, who has been Beijing's monetary authority chief since 2018. Now, Pan is known for taking a tough stance against currency speculators, leading China's foreign exchange agency. He was also involved in state banking reforms, tightening property market and fintech regulations, and in banning cryptocurrencies. As governor, Pan will have to deal with a downturn in the property sector and a mountain of local government debt. President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. meets with Malaysia's King Abdullah and Prime Minister Anwar Ibrahim. King Abdullah and Prime Minister Anwar welcomed Marcos and the Philippine delegation in a state ceremony at the National Palace on Wednesday. This was followed by talks between Marcos and the King. Marcos is also holding a bilateral meeting with Prime Minister Anwar, where they are expected to pursue areas of cooperation aligned with the perspective or respective economic agenda of both countries.
The Philippine Trade Department expected today several business establishments in Metro Manila. Our correspondent Jackie Pascual is on the line for more. Hi, Jackie.
Hi, Denise. The Department of Trade and Industry conducted several inspections in various establishments in Marikina. Among the shops visited were a vape shop, tiles shop, and a bookstore. DTI Undersecretary Ruth Castelo inspected the items at a bookstore to see the prices and if it follows the latest list of suggested retail price, or SRP, for school supplies. He said prices of most school supplies have increased by almost a peso, up to 11 pesos per item. The rise in prices is due to the increasing cost of raw materials. Castelo said the bookstore she inspected followed the SRP. Prices of pad papers, for example, range from 21 to 61 pesos depending on the brand. Pencil, for example, is from 11 to 17 pesos each. Ballpen, 9.25 to 19 pesos each. Of course, all these prices and items are, it depends on the brand and the quantity of the product. She now urges the parents to buy school supplies sold as a package or bundle, as it will be cheaper. And she also urged them to use or to reuse old school supplies that have not been not used that much or not yet been broken. Aside from bookstores, DTI also inspected a vape shop and several tiles store. At the vape shop, they discovered that the shop is selling flavored vape products, which is illegal. They seize the items and will issue a notice of violation to the store owner, who will then be asked to explain within 48 hours. Among these flavored vape products are, for example, those that are candy-flavored, fruits-flavored, dessert flavors, flavored, and those with cartoon characters. DTI said that these are not allowed as this is particularly appealing to minors and it is against the law. At the tile store, meanwhile, DTI officials discovered that many are selling uncertified tiles or ceramic tiles, or those which did not pass testing with DTI. Castelo said it is dangerous to sell uncertified products, that the tiles might fall on the consumers if it is substandard. DTI has sealed or placed a tape on the pile of tiles to make sure that it cannot be sold for now. Same with the vape shop, the DTI will also issue a notice of violation to the owners of these tile shops in Marikina. And that's the latest. Denise, back to you.
Jackie Pascual with that story. Thanks, Jackie.
The Philippines drops three spots in a global ranking which measures the attractiveness of countries as a destination for offshore and outsourcing activities. According to a report by global consultancy firm Kearney, out of 78 countries, the Philippines slipped to the 12th spot. Now, Kearney attributed the drop to the rise of Mexico and Colombia as nearshore capability centers, which both have a closer proximity to the United States. But the consultancy firm says the Philippines remains as the business process outsourcing engine of Asia, which is home to over 1,000 BPO firms employing over 1.2 million people. It also notes the top three countries, India, China, and Malaysia, continue to lead the index due to their immense cost advantage, abundant talent pool, and strong skills.
Australia's slaps Facebook owner Meta a huge fine over undisclosed data collection. An Australian court ordered Meta to pay $14 million in fines for collecting user data through a smartphone application that was advertised as a way to protect privacy. The judge said Facebook used the app Onavo to collect users' location, time and frequency using other smartphone apps and websites they visited for its own advertising purposes. Meta still faces a civil suit by Australia's Office of the Information Commissioner over its dealings with Cambridge Analytica in Australia. Microsoft and Google seeing better than expected earnings as a frenzy over artificial intelligence keeps market sentiment positive. The Bill Gates-led Microsoft in the last quarter saw profit and sales soaring to their highest ever levels. Microsoft says its net profit for the April to June period was at $20.1 billion, 20% higher year on year. The company also posted $56.2 billion in sales, beating expectations. Google's parent firm Alphabet also saw profit beat market forecasts. In the last quarter, the search engine giant reported a net income of $18.7 billion on revenue of $74.6 billion. Both Microsoft and Alphabet have launched an array of AI products since the Microsoft-backed OpenAI released ChatGPT in late 2022. Investors have been counting on the new products to help tech giants offset a slowdown in their cloud businesses. AI art has been making waves over the past year, but other technologies are also having an influence in the art scene, including the metaverse, which could soon change how we see art in the future. Take a look.
Does the future of art lie in the metaverse? Some digital artists say virtual reality, augmented reality, and artificial intelligence are already changing the art world.
It's not just the world of exhibitions and institutions. I guess the very notion of what an art piece can be will change.
Daniel Beerbohm runs Acute Art, a London-based digital media artist collaboration platform. He says the technology could revolutionize the world of exhibitions.
I mean, someone asked, will VR be in museums? And then I had to provoke this person and say, well, maybe museums will be in VR. And I think it's, you know, curatorially, what is an exhibition? How do you exhibit these things? What's an institution? I mean, in a way, when you do augmented reality that you can place outside, you can place it in the city and you can create dialogues with monuments or architecture with the city, you don't even need the museum, you don't need the biennial, you don't need the classical art fair. You can do it without anyone, actually.
Virtual reality creates brand new worlds or environments normally viewed through a headset, while augmented reality inserts artistic creations into existing worlds and can be viewed on a screen or a device. Acute Art and London's prestigious Royal College of Art are teaming up with some of the biggest names in the world of digital art to explore the changes and possibilities in a new short course.
I'm not saying that this is going to replace the physical experience of an art exhibition, but it is, democratizing, yes, because not everyone lives in London or Berlin or Paris or smaller capitals in Europe where there are big collections and art schools and all of that. In principle, this is a possibility to reach audiences anywhere where there's internet connection.
Today's numbers that matter, 800,000, that's how much Japan's total population dropped in 2022, according to recently released Japanese government data. The year also saw the country's 47 prefectures recording declines in population. Last year's drop marks Japan's 14th consecutive year of decline in population and the steepest since 1968. In contrast, the number of foreign nationals living in Japan has risen by around 289,000 to a record of nearly 3 million. Now, that's the biggest year-on-year increase since the Internal Ministry began tracking the data a decade ago.